Good morning, Tenney students. I'm Nayeli Sogando, and I hope you all enjoyed yesterday's video. Congratulations to This Is Not My Hat by Amber Rojas for winning your votes. Today, we have Mackenzie Moore reading The Crayon Man and Gabriel Oliveira reading Don't Let the Pigeon Drive the Bus. I hope you all enjoy yourself and have a wonderful day.
Hello, I'm the Blue Crayola Crayon, and now Mackenzie will be reading a story about my creator.
Hi, my name is Mackenzie Moore, and I'm going to be reading The Crayon Man, The True Story of the Invention of Crayola Crayons, by Natasha Bybow, illustrated by Steven Celerano. The Crayon Man. Once there was a man who saw color everywhere. He noticed the yellow-orange petals of the black-eyed Susan in his garden. He marveled at the rich scarlet-eyed tones of the cardinal's feathers. He admired the deep blue greens of the waves in the sea. Color made him really, really happy. But all day long at work, all he saw was black. Black dust, black tar, black smoke, black ink, black dye, black shoe polish. His company sold carbon black, a new kind of pigment or colored substance made from the soot of burning oil and natural gas. People used it in printing inks, electric street lamps, and stove and shoe polish. It also made rubber car tires last much longer. His name was Edward Binney, and he was an inventor. He worked with his cousin C. Harold Smith. Together, they were Binney and Smith. Harold was a great salesman. He loved to travel the world. Edwin was curious. He had a knack for listening and making what people needed. Edwin invented a new kind of inexpensive slate pencil that wrote very smoothly. It was gray. Children loved it. He invented a kind of chalk that wasn't dusty and didn't crumble. It was white. Teachers loved it. He invented a wax crayon that would write on wood and paper packaging. It was really, really black. People loved it. Paper was expensive in the 1800s, so children wrote with slate pencils or chalk on slates, small handheld blackboards. So when everyone, including Edwin's wife, Alice, told him that children needed better, cheaper crayons, he listened. They said, "The crayons we have are big, dull, and clumsy. The lumps of colored clay only make fat, clunky lines. And the artist crayons from Europe are far too expensive. They crumble and break easily. Some are even poisonous." Alice used to be a school teacher, so she knew what children needed. She encouraged Edwin to invent the crayons. Edwin thought about his company's inventions. When you drew a picture with their gray slate pencil, it rubbed off the drop of a hat. When you drew a picture with their white chalk, it smudged everywhere. If you drew a picture with Edwin's new really black crayon, it was, well, really black. None of these inventions was any good for drawing in color. So Edwin listened, and Edwin invented. In a small stone mill in Pennsylvania, in a top secret lab, Edwin's team experimented. How could they make better, stronger crayons? Melted paraffin wax? Perhaps. The first colored crayons invented in Europe were made from a mixture of charcoal and oil, so they broke easily. To make stronger crayons, Edwin tried using wax instead. Now for the crayon colors. Grinding, grinding, grinding up rocks and minerals into fine powders. Mixing, mixing. Slate for gray. Earth for yellow, red and brown. Perhaps, oh yes, and lapis for blue. Pounding, sifting, and heating the colored powders. Would they be bright enough? Edwin's team kept on trying. They kept on experimenting. Ground up rocks and minerals made bright pigments for crayons. Red iron oxide, hematite for red, yellow iron oxide, geothite for yellow, varied shades of red iron oxide for brown, carbon black for black, zinc oxide for white, and imported ultramarine made from lapis lazuli for blue. They came home covered in color. They experienced some more and discovered a pinch of this pigment, a sploosh of that one, a little hotter or a little cooler, and voila, lots of different shades. Now there were green, oranges, violets, and pinks too. Edwin came home covered in color. To make orange, green, and violet, chemists blended various pigments and clays. Some minerals changed color when heated, plus the length of time that mixtures were left to cool created different colors too. In a large tub at the mill, Edwin's team measured out the ingredients. Melted wax, clay to thicken, something for texture, colored powders, each in just the right amount every time to make. a top secret formula. Slowly, carefully, stirring by hand, they poured the special formula into thin, crayon-shaped molds, smaller than any other inventor's, just the right size for children's hands. The mixture coated, cooled, and hardened. Edwin watched, and Edwin waited. Children might eat or chew the crayons and get sick, so Edwin's team experimented to find new, safe, non-toxic colors and materials. Finally, one summer evening in June 1903, Edwin came home covered in color and announced that he'd invented a new kind of colored crayon. But what should he call it? Alice had an idea. She said, let's mix the French word cray for stick of chalk and the word Olaf from the word old genius, meaning oily, like the oily texture of the crayon wax, to invent a new word, Crayola. Edwin listened. Binney and Smith shipped out the first Crayola crayon boxes. Red, orange, yellow, green, blue, violet, brown, and black. 8 colored crayons for only a nickel. Edwin waited. Would children like them? Children did. Now they could draw a tiny green caterpillar or the big blue sky. Their drawings wouldn't smudge and they wouldn't rub out. They were bright and could last a long, long time. By the 1900s, inventors had figured out how to make cheaper paper from wood pulp, so children could now draw on paper instead of just slate. Excitement over the new colorful invention spread like wildfire. Admirers from far and wide flocked to marvel at Binney and Smith's inventions at the St. Louis World's Fair. The company's dustless chalk even won a gold medal. Proudly, Edwin and Harold showed it off, especially on their new Crayola crayon boxes. Every day, Edwin brought colorful bouquets from his garden to inspire the Crayola team. They made crayons in even more different shades and later asked children to help name some of them. To celebrate their 19th anniversary, Crayola held a color naming competition. The six-year-old winner coined Tropical Rainforest. Other color names created by children included Robin's Eggs Blue, Tickle Me Pink, and Macaroni and Cheese. At last, because of Edwin Binney, the man who saw color everywhere, who had a knack for listening and making what people needed, children all around the world could reach just for the right shade to draw anything. And these are how Crayola crayons are made today. In 1903, Crayola crayons were made carefully in small lots, labeled and packed into boxes by hand, and sold to schools. Today, machines produce an average of 12 million crayons a day. That's over 8,333 crayons a minute, in more than 120 different colors. They are sold in over 80 countries around the world. Train calls deliver paraffin wax to the Crayola factory in Easton, Pennsylvania. The wax is heated, and the clear melted liquid is stored in tall silos, ready to be pumped inside. Workers pour colored powders, called pigments, into vats filled with the liquid wax and clay to thicken it, then mix. The wax pigment mixture is pumped into a huge mold. It looks like a giant circular muffin tin. The mix fills all the 110 small crayon-shaped holes in each section. Cold water flows underneath the mold to cool the wax and harden it into crayon shapes. A large blade scrapes it off extra wax to be reused later. The crayons are pushed up from the mold. A robotic arm then moves them to the labeling machine. Pre-printed sticky labels on a huge drum are wrapped around each crayon 2.5 times. Workers check the finished crayons and store them in a large cardboard cartons, one for each color. To make up the Crayola crayon boxes, workers place the crayons in the right order in the collating machine. A chute drops one of each color needed into a conveyor belt. A robotic arm opens the flat packed green and yellow Crayola boxes and sends them out onto the conveyor belt. Another arm pushes the collated crayons into each box and closes it. The boxes move down the conveyor belt to be packed into larger cartons. Crayola ships the finished crayons to the store and they are sold to you. Thank you for watching. That was The Crayon Man.
Hi, I'm one of the Pigeon's friends, and Gabe will be reading a story all about him.
Hi, I'm Gabriel Oliver, and today I'm going to be reading Don't Let the Pigeon Drive the Bus, Words and Pictures by Mo Williams. Hi, I'm the bus driver. Listen, I've got to leave for a little while, so can you watch things for me until I get back? Thanks. Oh, and remember, don't let the pigeon drive the bus. I thought he'd never leave. Hey, can I drive the bus? Please? I'll be careful. I'll tell you what, I'll just steer. My cousin Herb drives a bus almost every day. True story. Vroom, vroomy, vroomy, vroom, vroom. Pigeon at the wheel. No, I never get to do anything. Hey, I've got an idea. Let's play drive the bus. I'll go first. Come on, just once around the block? I'll be your best friend. How about I give you $5? No fair. I bet your mom would let me. What's the big deal? It's just a bus. I have dreams, you know? Fine. Let me drive the bus. I'm back. You didn't let the pigeon drive the bus, did you? Great. Thanks a lot. Uh-oh. Bye. Hey.
Thanks for reading the book with me.